Terry and those of you who are joining us via Facebook and YouTube. We are the Welcoming Church on the River, and we are glad that you are here worshiping with us today on this beautiful Lord's Day. Your announcements are mailed or emailed to you, and I refer you to them for those important announcements. I'll highlight just a couple of things this morning. The session has called a congregational meeting for Sunday, July the 11th, following the 11 a.m. worship service. And the purpose for that meeting is to hear a report from the nominating committee about some of those committees that we did not elect earlier in the year, this year, such as the nominating committee, the scholarship committee, the memorial committee, auditors. And so you'll hear a report from the nominating committee about those committees, and we will vote on their suggestions. We also will be talking about our bylaws. They have not been updated in some time, and our corporate administration committee has been working hard to take a look at them and bring recommendations to the session who have approved them. And so we bring them before you for your vote. They will be emailed to you. If you would like a hard copy, you can find them in the church office if you would like to take this with you to take a look at them ahead of time. There are other announcements in here in our newsletter bulletin, including our first fellowship event since we have opened back up. And you will want to find all of these announcements, including volunteer opportunities. Also, we have a continued prayer request for Shirley and for Ginger, for Kathy and Jennifer, for George, for Dick, for Eric. I would also ask your prayers for the family and friends of the Lord Boykin, who died this week. And so let's be in prayer for that family. There are birthdays and anniversaries this week as well. Linda and Bill celebrate an anniversary tomorrow, and Barbara celebrates a birthday tomorrow. Isabella celebrates a birthday in a couple of days, and Barbara celebrates a birthday later this week. And so when you see them, you're going to have to say happy birthday or happy anniversary. It is so good to see a number of your faces that I have not seen in a while in worship, and so welcome, glad to be here together. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
God, arise.
Jesus, our Lord, is coming near.
He reaches out with love and healing.
He raises us up to new life. Let us worship God.
Our opening hymn is number 667, When Morning Gilds the Skies.
By the power of your Spirit, speak your word to us, O God. Show us who you are and who you are calling us to be. We pray this in your holy name. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is Psalm 130, and it can be found on page 573 in your pew Bible. Out of the depths I cry for you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you might be revered. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits. In his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who redeemed Israel from all of his iniquities. Immediately aware that power had gone out from her. mind the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord, it stands forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So if we have some young disciples with us this morning, I would ask them some questions about what kinds of healing that Jesus does. So you get to be the young disciples and just shout out your answers. What kinds of healing does Jesus do?
Physical
healing. Okay, like in our story today. What else?
Mental
healing for someone who may need to be healed of a mental illness. Okay? All right, what other? Spiritual healing. And? Okay. Healing for the natural order around us, okay? Any other kinds of healing that you think of? Well, today we heard the story of Jesus doing some physical healing, a woman who had a horrible wound of some sort that had been bleeding for 12 years, and she had seen a doctor and nobody could help her. And Jesus made her well. And we hear of another kind of healing where a little girl has died and the father is distraught. He didn't know at first that she was dead, and he got on his knees and begged for Jesus to help. And Jesus did. So we know that Jesus is interested in healing. As we think about it this morning, let's consider what are the different ways that Jesus heals us. It could be much larger than physical healing. Let us pray. God, we are grateful that you are always with us, always for us, and always interested in our healing, whatever form that might be. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Nice job, young disciples. When I hear the word expectancy, when you hear that word, the sermon title today is a posture of expectancy. What do you think of? I think of baby birds. Baby birds in the nest, and mom and daddy has come in with the catch of the day, and they're, how do they look? They're in I think of the last couple of months of pregnancy in which the mom might be preparing the nursery, cleaning the entire house from top to bottom, and then doing it again because she missed something. Expectancy. Can you relate? And in each situation, whether it's with birds or human beings, it feels like the air is charged with a kind of electricity and anticipation as we see creatures getting ready by being in the right posture. Today's gospel passage from Mark has that same air of expectancy. First, a religious leader in the synagogue shows up on his knees, begging Jesus to heal his beloved daughter. A desperate man, he demonstrates persistence and determination on his daughter's behalf. He has a posture of expectancy as he demands attention from Jesus. Likewise, an unnamed woman in the crowd ignores all social convention and reaches out to Jesus for healing. She exhibits persistence and determination that will put her in the right place at the right time for healing. It was no light thing, for she had an illness that had bankrupted her and kept her isolated for 12 years. Now, we have just, and still are, been through a pandemic that kept us isolated, many of us, for about a year, right? Can you imagine 12 years? The gospel writer tells us these two important stories, one sandwiched in the other. He tells us this for an important purpose. There are many, I think, remarkable things we can learn from this story in Mark. I will mention just a couple of things. The first lesson that we learn in this passage is what faith looks like. We have an unnamed woman who for the past 12 years has been unable to be in a crowd without yelling, "Unclean! Unclean!" to those around her so that no one could make the mistake of accidentally brushing up against her and making that person ritually unclean just by touching her. So she has to yell unclean. She would not have been allowed to attend synagogue or hang out with her friends 12 years. Not only that, but we read that she has spent all of her money on doctors who had not helped her at all. So now she was not only alone, but poor as well. So no money and isolated, she was a desperate person. But apparently, she had heard about Jesus and his healing power. And she was determined and persistent enough to snub what she should do in favor of what she felt she must do. She snuck up behind Jesus or stood beside him and touched his robes, determined to feel his power and healing. She did not have the confidence to approach him directly, believing that she would have been chastised, dismissed, or ignored out of hand. But that did not stop her from a kind of subterfuge. She could have received severe punishment, perhaps death, for not keeping her distance from him and from everyone else in the crowd. So we learn that faith looks like ignoring all social convention, risking everything, and being determined enough to put yourself in a position to receive a blessing. Next, we have a synagogue leader attend synagogue. This was the man. We have a synagogue leader who also ignores his own group's social convention of snubbing the so-called radical Jesus. He was considered radical, you remember. The synagogue leaders didn't like him. He was always breaking the rules and associating with people that he shouldn't associate with. So the synagogue leader, was also breaking or ignoring his own group's social convention because he loved his gravely ill 12-year-old daughter. If the other synagogue leaders knew what he was doing, they might have reported him to the presbytery and written maybe letters to the General Assembly or his association with Jesus. And they certainly would frown on his plea for Jesus' help and lowering himself to beg. But apparently, Jairus had heard of Jesus' healings and his compassion for those who were suffering. Jairus was just desperate enough to ignore social convention and get on his knees in front of the man to beg help for his daughter. I'm sure he was put on a watch list after this by his superiors, if not demoted in some way. So faith, once again, looks like determination and persistence to put yourself in the position to receive a blessing. We've often thought of and talked about faith as if it were a noun, have we not? Something that you have or you don't have. That's what faith is. However, the epistle writer James would beg to differ. He says faith without works is nothing. In fact, he says it's dead. No faith at all. So is it a noun? Kathleen Norris, in her book Amazing Grace, A Vocabulary of Faith, says faith is really more of a verb than a noun. It's more something you do than something you have. It is determination, persistence, desperation even, and placing yourself in the position of expectancy, even to the point of ignoring all social convention that is around you. Faith, according to these combined stories of Mark, is like that. Most of the time, faith looks like something else for us, I think. We think it is a kind of tacit belief that may or may not stand up when tested. Instead, Jesus says in another passage, faith looks like a persistent widow who nags a judge to death until she receives what she needs. Well, that's interesting. Faith looks like someone nagging someone else. Who knew, right? Faith is a verb. It is acted out, and it will risk everything get what is needed and hoped. Now, all of that begs the question. Let's pause a moment and wonder together with the text about whether this applies, this example, this scripture passage, applies in any and in all circumstances. Is this text prescriptive for all circumstances? Does this mean that Jesus will heal all sick people who are desperate and who fall on their knees in prayer and ask and who demand healing? Is that what this text means? Some have staked this claim for sure. That if we have just enough faith, if we are persistent enough, then all of our prayers and wishes will be answered. After all, the common line that is said is, prayer works. Illnesses will be healed. miracles will happen if we have enough faith, is that theological claim. I'm afraid that that line of thinking, though, pushes the text farther than what is intended. I don't think God is some sort of cosmic vending machine, that if we put in just enough money or just enough faith and hit all of the right buttons, we will receive exactly what we hope. Most of us, I think, have the wisdom and experience to know that God does not work in that way. Not all illnesses are miraculously healed, even with the biggest and most active of faiths. Some illnesses are healed and some are not. The question of why God seems to miraculously intervene in some circumstances and not in others, well, it's not been adequately answered by any of us, including a number of us preachers. I do not know why some people of faith have a life filled with smooth sailings, while other people of faith struggle mightily from day to day. I do not understand the difference. What I do know is that Jairus' daughter was healed that day and lived until she died again another day. And that the hemorrhaging woman was healed that day to live and die another day. Because that is the nature of life on this planet that God created. Also, what I do know is that healing takes a variety of forms, as some of you mentioned earlier. The illness may remain, but peace, courage, and calm reassurance may be the gift of healing given. I also do know that the one who heals can be trusted to be with us and for us always, even to the end. That's what Scripture promises. Unlike what our culture teaches us, that God helps those who help themselves, i.e., God helps those who have enough faith. Instead of that, God helps those who cannot help themselves and who choose to cry out from the depths of their pain, as the psalmist says. So faith looks like desperate people putting themselves in the position to receive a gift from God, whatever that gift might be. That's one thing we learn from this text. The second remarkable thing we learn about this passage is the observation that Jesus is able to be interrupted from whatever agenda was on his mind for that day. And his response to that interruption was not irritation like some of us when we get interrupted. His response to that interruption was compassion. Many times we, individually and corporately, well, we have a plan in mind, an agenda for the day, an agenda for 5 years or for 2 years, and we are determined to not allow anything to disrupt our plan, right? But people are desperate all around us. And we must be willing to listen and discern a way to compassionately respond. We must be willing to be interrupted from our best laid plans. Jesus walked from town to town, doing one-on-one healing ministries and restoring people back to community. The woman who was healed was restored back to community. She could go to synagogue. to what my parents want me to be, or I'll never be able to achieve that, or maybe the church is on its way out, or we need to keep those people out of the church. Negative expectations. Or we can have the wrong expectations and never place ourselves in the right position to receive a blessing. And never exercise our faith in the way Jesus intends, and consequently never grow in the way God would have us grow, and never be who we were created to be. We can have the wrong expectations, both individually, personally, and corporately. Jairus and the hemorrhaging woman both cried out from the depths of their pain, and they moved out of their comfort zone. They knelt before Jesus and placed their trust in the one who cares about them and who happens to be fundamental good. Question is, how desperate are we? Will we, as individuals, as a church, be willing to move out of our comfort zones and out of social convention to place our trust in the God who is both with us and for us? Will we? To follow Jesus, we must. Let us look at the world around us with eyes of compassion, just like Jesus, so that we may demonstrate faith by responding to the needs that we see. To do anything less, well, it puts us in the wrong posture. Amen. Let us stand and affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. Let us confess the faith of our baptism.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and stood on the right hand of God.
seated.
Hello, my name is Sharon Kermas.
Sharon Kermas.
And I'm giving a moment for missions today. I want to give you a little bit of history. First of all, I have a word from Psalm 99. The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed. Kind of like what was said in our sermon today. Makes sense. C-E-N-T-S. Don't you think? Sensibility originated in 1976 as Two Cents a Meal, a project begun by the Presbyterian Women to involve individuals and families in a corporate response to the world's hunger. Over the years, presbyteries have developed similar programs entitled Pennies for Hunger, Nickel a Meal, and many of these programs benefit hunger ministries as well as the national and international projects of the Presbyterian Hunger Program. We in Central Florida Presbytery call it PATH, P-A-T-H, Presbyterians Answer to Hunger. And here at Broncos Presbyterian Church, we try to collect this offering two times a year. Central Florida PATH was formed in 1982 by Reverend John Jackson, the first hunger enabler, and 22nd Harvest Food Bank has remained in our offering for 38 years. We now have 5 cents a meal offering, and we give a certain percentage locally to Second Harvest Food Bank of Central Florida, distributing 92 million meals, 96 million meals a year for people in need in Orange County, Seminole, Osceola, Lake, Brevard, and Volusia, 550 organizations. We also give a certain percentage to the Society for St. Andrew. It is a national nonprofit leaning organization distributing fresh produce to food banks, church pantries, and homeless shelters all throughout the state of Florida. A gleaning process takes place from farms, fields, residential growers, and trains using thousands of volunteers gleaning nutritious food that would have gone to waste, but now are sent to all these places around our state. And it says there are about 4 to 6 million pounds of this food to every place in our state. The other global areas we give to are getting a certain percentage. You can find these percentages in the bulletin, by the way. One is the Republic of Guatemala, and then Nicaragua, AIR, which stands for Alliance for International Reforestation, Incorporated. And the Republic of Madagascar is an island country, by way of FBEE, Madagascar, which stands for the Fruits, Vegetables, and Environmental Education Program. And this one is teaching farmers how to grow and graft trees, especially mangoes. We know about mangoes here. And getting internships for agricultural students from the universities. Wonderful use of sense. And then a small percentage of our collection will be used in grants for some churches to continue hunger relief in their own communities. And another percentage is for administration. People working with our Central Florida 5 cents a meal are G. Hickerson for Second Harvest Food Bank of Central Florida, Barbara Sales, Florida Regional Director for Florida End Hunger Organization and Society of St. Andrew, Ann Hullum for AirGuatemala.org, Dr. Dan Turk and his wife Elizabeth Turk in Madagascar. So please read your brochure provided in the bulletin. And it's on the table out in the narthex, as well as envelopes. We will be taking up collections the entire month of July. You can put it all in one Sunday of July or every Sunday of July. And since we do it twice a year, it's about 180 days worth of 5 cents a meal. which turns out to be $27. So that's a kind of a collection goal, in a way, for the month of July, for each person that wants to contribute, and we hope you want to. And I use QuickPay, but there's so many people that don't have coins anymore, but some do. Please put them into dollars so that they can be counted more easily. Okay, thank you very much. The envelopes for the 5 cents a meal are also in the archives. And if you prefer to write a check, you can always do so. Make it out to Rockledge Presbyterian Church and write PATH PATH in the memo line. And again, this is during the month of July. You can give any time though. You know the generous grace and love of our Lord Jesus Christ, do you not? In gratitude for his great mercy and love, let us give generously so that others may also learn of his great mercy and love. Let us give.
Thank you.
please use these gifts, your tithes, to accomplish your will and purpose. Help us to give compassionately to others whom we see all around us. This we pray in your holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. Holy and grace-giving God, you created us and we are yours. You sent your Son to show us the way to live, and you sent your Spirit to energize and enlighten us. Give us courage. We are grateful for your love and mercy all of our days. We confess that we are often self-centered, find it difficult to move out of our comfort zones. Like Jairus and the hemorrhaging woman, you ask us to recognize your goodness and healing mercy and put ourselves in a position to receive them. You ask us to be more like them, willing to risk all for your touch. Help us to imagine more, expect more, and pray more so that we may place ourselves in the position witness miracles, both in our lives and in the lives of others around us. Give us hope for the living of these days, we pray. Give us courage and imagination for how things might be better as you work toward the completion of your kingdom. Convict us of where we need correction and when we err. Help us to always err on the side of mercy and compassion. Today we ask your healing mercies and compassion for the family of Laurie Boykin, for Shirley, for Ginger. We pray healing for Jennifer, for George, for Dick, and Vivian. And we ask your mercy and compassion for the people searching for loved ones in the Miami area after the condo collapse. We ask your presence, your courage, your love, your sustaining grace for each one working to find those who have been buried. And we lift to you others who are on our hearts and minds. We also pray for our civic leaders that you will inspire them to do what is good and right for the citizens of this country and for the citizens of your whole created world. Now hear us as we pray the prayer you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. As we stand and sing our sending hymn, I'll ask Rob to play through it once as we listen. We've sung this before, but it may still be a little unfamiliar to you. And then, after he plays through it once, we'll sing it twice. Let us stand and sing.
Thank you.
may know the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the energy, the imagination, the courage of the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore.